Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Not Another Musical Podcast. I am Allie Teeples.
I am Mark Torres.
And we have had another week of pretty much the same, except a different show this time.
Yeah. Well, I mean, how was your Rona week?
Well, I think I said this last time, but I took a lot of baths. Okay. And I took a lot of drives.
It's been a hot week.
Okay, that's the one thing that was different.
Yeah.
Is we've been, I'm just afraid to look at our utility bill for this month.
Samesies. It's been, with the working at home thing, that's been constant. The air is just like constantly running.
Awful.
And yeah, it's going to be.
I thought I was dying a couple days ago. Today was a little bit overcast.
Okay.
But the past couple days.
It's still not nice.
It's not, I am not going to sit here and tell you it was nice.
Yeah.
I'd be like, you know what? Okay, here's the thing. Someone said this and I 100% agree. I think the only reason that people like summer is because when we were in school, we were trained to like summer because it was the one time we didn't have to go to school. Exactly. But honestly,
yeah, no, it sucks.
Now it's the same as any other time.
They can keep it.
And I like fall.
Yeah. Give me winter, man. Give me Christmas carols.
I love Christmas time.
Yeah.
But I also love fall. You know what? We don't really have a fall here.
Sure.
But when I lived in the South, that was like one of the one like positive experiences of living in the South was like experiencing
crunchy
all four seasons. Crunchy leaves.
Yeah.
Colorful leaves.
Yeah.
So many trees. Did I ever tell you the story of when I moved to the South and
you've told me several stories.
This isn't a bad one. So I immediately got sick.
Okay.
And I'm like prone to bronchitis. So I had bronchitis and I went to the doctor and he was like, I know why you have this. It's because you're from California and you guys have really bad air quality. Yep. So your body's rejecting the clean air. And I was like, what?
That's contrary to logic, but okay.
It was having like a cleansing.
My body's not processing this clean air.
I don't know what this non-polluted, non-smoggy bullshit you call air is here, but I don't like it. My body doesn't like it.
Like, did you just get over it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Really? And then when I moved back here, I got sick again. So, because my body was like, oh, that's right. Poison. We're not used to that anymore.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Well, you know, toss-ups.
Get this. So I actually had like a Rona-fueled nightmare this week.
Oh, yep.
I don't know if it was Rona fueled, but it was a nightmare.
Blame it on it.
It's Rona.
It's fine.
Right? I had a vivid dream, that we were going on with Spamalot.
Okay.
I was backstage. I was in costume, but we just never rehearsed. Like it was time to go on. It was time to make my entrance. And I was like, son of a bitch, I don't remember this stuff.
I did that with the Little Mermaid the other night.
Yeah. So I think I did that maybe like 6 years ago, 5 years ago. And, you know, you'd like to think you know a lot of it. But in that frozen, fearful moment in your dream where it's like vivid and stuff.
And also in your dream, like your mind isn't the same.
No,
so
no.
Nothing.
I was just.
And you probably thought things that weren't even in the show were supposed to be correct.
Of course. Well, yeah, it was different. And I remember like not, I don't think actually participating, but I think as the goings on were going on that were happening already before my entrance, I remember, I think I thought like, that's not consistent with what I remember of the show, you know?
Right.
But I was like frozen solid in my dream. Like, oh my God, this can't be happening. This can't be happening. I can't go on, you know?
It was
just really, really scary.
I legitimately did that same thing with a Little Mermaid. Like I was about to go on as Ariel. And then in my dream, I was like, wait, I don't know Ariel.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was I going to tell you? Now I forgot.
Yeah. Well,
but that happens. Oh, that happens all the time. Where in my dream, I think I'm still in college.
Okay.
And it gets to the end of a semester and I completely forgot about a class I signed up for 4 months ago and I just never went.
You never went? Oh.
And then I found
out that
I'm failing.
By choice. Sounds like you just dreamt about it.
Well, and I'm like, I'm 25. Why am I still dreaming about that?
Because college is a dream.
Yeah. Well.
Not anymore, girl.
Yeah.
So sad.
I know.
So I like your tiara.
Thank you.
Why are you wearing a tiara? Is it just because you're fancy and you like to wear tiaras?
Because, friend, this week we're talking about Once Upon a Mattress.
Oh.
Is that why you're wearing a crown too?
Yeah.
You look like the Burger King.
Well, that's cool, I guess.
I think it's cool.
Yeah.
He had nice
hair. Does he have nice songs?
Does Burger King have a jingle?
It probably did in the 80s. Everything had a jingle in the 80s.
but I don't remember it.
Isn't that like those? I'll have to look that up later.
I'm sure there,
there was a really good one for like the chicken sandwich or something.
Maybe.
Okay. I might be making this up. What a good musical idea.
Yeah. Burger King the musical. I think actually McDonald's the musical would be better because you've got those characters. You've got the Hamburglar. The Hamburglar. Which I mean, immediate antagonist. The Grimace. The Grimace. Yeah.
What's the, isn't there like a, oh no, am I thinking of Chuck E. Cheese?
I only remember Grimace and the Hamburglar.
Ronald McDonald.
There's definitely other ones.
I mean, Ronald McDonald is the guy.
Obviously.
It's the bandit, the purple one.
That's Grimace.
And then isn't there like a duck? No, there's a big fluffy girl one. I think I'm thinking of Chuck E. Cheese.
Well, I don't think they'll give us the rights to write this anyway.
But
it would work.
We'll do it.
We could make it work.
We can make it like a jukebox musical and just pick a...
Songs about hamburgers? I'm sure there are some. There's got to be something about like...
It's just all about food.
Or about like being in a diner.
Yeah. Or they do the apple pies. We could get like Don McLean's song.
Okay.
Speaking of which...
That song's like 8 minutes long. My buddy has it in his jukebox and it's on 2 45s. And you kids don't know what 45s
are. I do.
But a long time ago, music used to come on a piece of vinyl.
No, my old room in North Carolina, my decor was all record covers on the wall. Okay. That's what I wanted. Of course, I didn't put like the records on the wall because why would you do that? But okay. I put the covers on the wall. And one of them was the cover of, it's a 45 of the B-52s.
Mm.
Which, cool. Like, I'm not, like, the biggest B-52s lady, but it's a cool cover.
So a friend of mine, she does, like, virtual trivia night with her friends.
Oh, fun.
She doesn't consider it cheating to ask me questions, but she doesn't Google. Like, she refuses to Google something, but she doesn't consider
she
it cheating
She can phone a friend,
me.
Though.
Yeah, yeah. And so this was either yesterday or 2 days ago, she sent me a clip. She's like, have you ever heard this song? And I swear to Christ, it was Love Shack. And I was who the hell are you? Right. And she's like, yeah, what is this?
No one's saying
it. Are you shitting me?
Look,
right
it
now?
Doesn't even have to be good. But
it wasn't like,
who hasn't heard Love Shack?
If it would have been like Vibrant Thing, I'd have been like, nobody knows Vibrant Thing.
I feel like
Love Shack?
It's inexcusable if you don't know Love Shack and Rock Lobster.
Right. Yeah.
The other ones, Tin Roof, Buzz.
I mean, it's like you hear it every single night in a karaoke hall.
Yeah.
You used to hear it a lot at like weddings. People would go nuts.
Why do people like to sing Rock Lobster so much? I don't know. I can't.
Oh, I didn't mean that one. I meant Love Shack. You hear Love Shack a lot at karaoke. Rock Lobster is too kitschy.
Oh, no. Maybe I think I just got them twisted. I definitely have heard. It's the, I got me a card.
Yeah.
You always have it like two girls and
the
guy.
It's fantastic because, I mean, everyone sings their face off in that song.
Yeah, I know.
So it's actually a really good party karaoke
B-52 is jukebox musical. Except there's
only
two songs.
yeah, I like it.
Okay, well, without further ado, this week's musical is Once Upon a Mattress. We're very excited to talk about it. So,
everybody, places.
Thank you,
places.
The curtain's up.
The seats are full.
It's not another musical.
All right, so let's pile in our time machine and set it for the year 1959. Ooh. That's the year this musical premiered. And here are some of the things that are going on in the world.
Take me there.
All right. So President Eisenhower is our president.
Okay.
And so let's say we wanted to buy a house. Do you have any idea how much we would have to pay for that?
$12.
You're close. It's actually...
Wait, let me give it a real guess.
Okay.
1959. Is this a Southern California home or is this a mean United States home?
I honestly don't even think it really mattered.
All right. I'm going to say $26,000.
No. Are you ready?
Fuck. This is going
to... $12,400.
God damn it. That's infuriating.
I know. Right? It just makes you want to die.
Ugh.
Okay. A gallon of gas was 25 cents.
Oh, take me back.
A car was $2,200.
Yeah, well, and they were good cars.
And they were good cars.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's like, that's not like, oh, like shitty little, no, no, like you had a cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. If we wanted to go to a movie, we'd pay $1 each.
Stop.
And if we wanted to buy a loaf of bread, it was 20 cents.
Okay.
Yep. So things that were happening here, kind of like notable things. Alaska and Hawaii were admitted as the 49th and 50th state of the union.
Oh, word. Welcome.
Yep. Hello. Shout out Hawaii and Alaska. Yeah.
Mahalo.
What do they say in Alaska? Hi. The Grammy Awards started.
Started?
In 1959.
Mm-hmm. Were they ever good? Probably in 1959 they were good.
Yeah, sure.
They were probably good through like 1977.
I'll get to talking about the singers of the day that were notable. So yeah. Okay. The Guggenheim was completed by Frank Lloyd Wright.
All right, the Googs.
I love Frank Lloyd Wright. That's my grandparents' house was built based on his designs.
Oh, word.
Yeah.
I like that.
Rodgers and Hammerstein's last musical, The Sound of Music, opened on Broadway.
Wow, I've heard of that. I wonder if it was any good.
We're going to get into those lesser known musicals pretty soon. Don't feel bad if you haven't heard of The Sound of Music. We're experts.
These people don't know yet. The Sound of Music draws very, very vivid Vietnam flashbacks for me. So The Sound of Music was one of like two or three VHSs that my aunt had. And she was literally like the only aunt that would ever babysit us.
Yeah.
And so you just had to listen to
Edelweiss all the time.
It was Grease, Sound of Music, and there was a third one that we never. I love Grease. So I don't know why I didn't repress Grease.
I think here's the thing.
But I repressed the shit out of The Sound of Music.
I think when we actually have to do The Sound of Music, you'll be pleasantly surprised.
I'll probably enjoy it.
Yeah, of course.
Like, I'm telling you, it takes me right back to it is straight up like Vietnam flashback.
All right, so on a darker note, the plane transporting Buddy Holly, Richie Valens, and Big Bopper goes down in a tragedy coined as the day the music died.
The music died.
As
girl.
In American Pie. It's on
yes,
a plane.
Thank you. I'm well aware of it.
Yeah.
There was a short lived, I saw it on West End, mm-hmm. show called Buddy. Mm-hmm. I think it did tour here.
Yeah.
It was bitching, dude. It felt like you were at a concert in the 50s. It was like, it was the story of Buddy, but it was the tour. It followed the tour. So there's a Richie Valens character. There's a Big Bopper character.
Uh-huh.
And like, I don't remember if it was Act 1 or Act 2. Probably Act 1, because I would imagine Act 2 ended with him dead. But I remember Act 1 ended, and you just felt like you were at a concert. They were like throwing they passed out flyers that said like, you know, tonight only. And it was a really, really bitchin' show.
Man. Yeah. It sounds awesome.
Yeah.
And then Ben-Hur premiered in New York City.
Oh, I've heard of that.
Yeah. So popular films of the time were Ben-Hur, obviously.
There it is.
Some Like It Hot.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Which is also on our list.
Yeah.
Anatomy of a Murder.
Okay.
North by Northwest. Mm-hmm. And Sleeping Beauty. I'm wearing my Sleeping Beauty crown today.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Singers, popular singers of the day were Doris Day.
Oh.
Frank Sinatra.
Get me there.
Connie Francis. Jim Reeves.
Jesus.
Cliff Richard and Ella Fitzgerald.
Do you remember when musicians used to make good music? Jesus Christ.
This was quite the year.
Wow.
Some notable births that year.
Okay.
Jason Alexander.
Costanza.
Yeah. Simon Cowell.
Okay. Where?
Fred Couples.
Don't know.
Who
him.
We found out was a number one in the world golf champion.
Okay.
Not in 1959, obviously, because he was a baby. But,
probably, yeah.
Yeah. And then Hugh Laurie.
House.
Yeah.
Dr. House.
Mm-hmm.
Word.
Notable deaths. We have Ethel Barrymore.
Okay. I would just assume that she's somehow related to Drew Barrymore.
That's a whole... She comes from John Barrymore. Like,
oh, it's like a whole thing?
A whole line.
They're
of,
the Kennedys?
They're the Kennedys of acting, okay. Essentially. Mario Lanza and Errol Flynn.
Okay. So, I mean... Do we stop and talk about? Do we pour some out?
No,
for Mario Lanza?
We're waiting. We're waiting until we get to
Mario Lanza. Those of you who don't know, I mean, you just get lost in this abyss. Go onto your Spotify. Just type in Mario Lanza, and just melt into the most glorious tenor to have ever
opera,
walked.
Opera, classical,
to have ever walked our earth.
Amazing.
Yes.
So some other just like miscellaneous pop culture things that I found. Bonanza premiered on NBC as the first weekly in-color series.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That's pretty big.
It is big,
1959.
Right? Yeah. Xerox launched its first commercial copy machine.
Okay. Was it the size of a house?
You know how curious.
Was it the size of a $12,000 house? Was it $12,000?
$12,400. That was the average, too. So some less, some more.
Okay.
Yeah. The first weather station was launched into space. Mm-hmm. De Beers launched its first synthetic diamond.
Okay. Is it on your tiara?
Yeah. These are all my De Beers diamonds. The microchip was invented. Mm. And it was the birth of the Etch-a-Sketch.
Oh, fun.
Yeah. That's fun, right?
Yeah,
so that was our little, time travel segment into 1959. Now let's get into Once Upon a Mattress. Can you let us know about the history?
Yeah. Once Upon a Mattress, musical comedy with music by Mary Rogers, who is the daughter of Richard Rogers.
I love the fact that he made his last musical in 1959.
And then she's just swinging for the fences here. Yep. And you know what's really cool, like before we even get into it, but like it clearly has the structure of an old timey.
Yeah. You can tell it was written in 1959.
And it doesn't like feel like Rodgers and Hammerstein, but it kind of. But it's feels influenced. Like Rodgers. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's got a nice feel to it.
You know what a friend of mine said today actually is, I will preface by saying that we had a really hard time like finding a professional production of this show. We had to reference.
We watched the movie.
We did. We watched the movie, the Wonderful World of Disney movie episode. It was a made for TV segment.
Mr. Schuster.
Yeah. So we did see that, but the stage musical has some things added.
Yeah.
So he said
some things that weren't removed.
That weren't yeah. So he said that a lot of people overlook the show because it plays like really stuffy and old sometimes. Yeah. So people are like a little bit detracted from it. Because you know how it is. Like the revivals always do like these big new like making it fresh. Well, and Once Upon a Mattress just didn't really do that.
We'll get into how that'll
But affect. I just thought that was interesting.
It's longevity. So yes. Lyrics are by Marshall Bearer. And the book is by Jay Thompson, Dean Fuller, and the same Marshall Bearer. So Marshall Bearer was a lyricist and a librettist. It opened off-Broadway May of 1959, moved to Broadway the same year. Okay, it was written as a play based off of the play, the 1835 Hans Christian Andersen fairy tale, The Princess and the Pea.
Yes.
It was first written, though, as a stage play.
Okay.
And then it was quickly adapted to music and then quickly expanded for the Broadway stage.
Yeah.
It moved very, very quickly. So from off-Broadway, May 11, 1959, at the Phoenix Theater, same year transferred to the Broadway at the Alvin Theater, which is now the Neil Simon. After several other Broadway theaters along the way, it finally lands at the St. James, and it has a run of 244 performances, which is not bad. 1959, man, that's almost a year. That's pretty cool. Broadway musical was directed by George Abbott, choreographed by Joe Layton. The show marked the Broadway debut of one Miss Carol Burnett.
Wonderful.
Right? Originating the role of Princess Winifred. Now, pause. I know that you and I aren't really old enough to remember the Carol Burnett show, but how bitchin' was the Carol Burnett show?
Yeah, she's hilarious. Did you happen to see when the Carol Burnett show started?
I did.
It was in
not.
The 60s, right?
Right. It did say that it was a, it said like this was Carol Burnett's stage debut, and she would later go on to be famous for being a TV hostess.
Right.
Yeah. But yeah, that show was just so freaking funny. Her and Tim Conway. Tim Conway was just, that stuff was just gold back then, man. August of 1960, soon after closing its Broadway run, rehearsals started for a seven-month U.S. tour, which was city to city by train, truck, and bus. Okay?
Yeah.
London West End production at the Adelphi Theater was very quick. September 20th, 1960, it only ran for 24 performances.
Okay.
Sad. So. Show was revived. It opened December 19 of 1996 at the Broadhurst. And that closed May 31st of 1997 after 188 performances with 35 previews.
Nice.
That production starred Sarah Jessica Parker as Winifred, David Aaron Baker, Louis Cleel, Heath Lamberts, Tom Allen Robbins, David Hibbard, and Jane Krakowski as Lady Larkin.
Oh, nice.
What a perfect casting, Jane Krakowski. I mean, she was a baby, yeah. Probably.
Yeah.
But I love her, like, so much.
Love that.
She's so talented. There were some TV adaptations, which we talked about. So, 1964, the first television adaptation was aired June 3rd of 64 on
the
CBS.
Carol Burnett Show? That was the Carol Burnett Show special, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. The production was videotaped in black and white.
Yep.
In front of a live audience.
And apparently, according to YouTube, filmed on a potato because we could not find a good...
Oh, yeah, I mean, like, dude, it's almost 60 years old. The footage is really, really... It's almost unwatchable. It's really rough.
That was a bit of a bummer.
So due to the reduced running time of 90 minutes, several songs and scenes were either cut or shortened. The conflict, which we will get into concerning Sir Harry and Lady Larkin... was downplayed to that they were married in secret instead of the whole, secret pregnancy
thing. Yeah.
72, the second television adaptation was broadcasted December 12, 1972. This production, videotaped in color, included original Broadway cast members, Burnett, Guilford, and White. Amongst those to join the original cast members was, any guess? As Lady Larkin, 1972. Broadway goddess, Bernie.
Bernadette.
Yeah.
We love.
Yeah. So again, several songs were eliminated and characters were combined and or altered, which we don't really like. I really miss. So my biggest. Well, let's get one more. So 2005, third television adaptation aired December 18, 2005, as part of The Wonderful World of Disney, starring Carol Burnett
That's
as
when
the
we saw.
Queen. Mm-hmm. Dennis O'Hare as Prince Dauntless, Tom Smothers as King Sextimus. Okay, so like watching this show, we haven't even talked about this yet, but the king is mute. And this is like a role that I just would not envy, like trying to be
funny. You have to pantomime everything for the entire show until the end.
Yes.
Yeah.
That being said, Tom Smothers is just a brilliant casting for that. With it, those limitations of like, hey, be funny without opening your mouth.
Yeah.
Tom Smothers. Obviously, hilarious.
It's perfect for physical actors.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
I feel like it's like a horrible undertaking to try to be funny and charming and memorable without speaking. You know what I mean? But anyway. Tracy Ullman as Princess Winifred, Zooey Deschanel as Lady Larkin, and Matthew Morrison, Mr. Schuster, as Sir Harry.
Nice.
Yeah. So that one cut the minstrel, which immediately like kind of broke my heart. The minstrel's a narrator.
And that's why we didn't see that.
Yeah. So, let me finish this. But cuts the minstrel, which, and they made some changes to some songs because of that.
Obviously, you can't do the minstrel, the jester, and the king song.
Yeah. And there were also changes to like how the plot of finding out the queen's secret test. There were changes to like how they figured that out. I thought most of the changes were cute. They worked for me, but I missed the minstrel. The minstrel just kind of like, he narrates.
Yeah.
From the stage version, from the moment the curtain comes up, the minstrel comes out, tells you that you're about to hear the story of the princess and the pea.
Yeah, and he said, this one just happened differently. I was there.
Right.
Which is cool.
And then he has like little songs along the way that still move the story, even if like there's one song that he only sings for like 15 or 20 seconds, mm-hmm. and it still moves the story.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And so, I feel like it should have been there. I missed that.
Well, the whole thing was truncated by like 45 minutes.
Yeah. So hit me with synopsis. I couldn't figure out why. Let's tell these people what this is about.
So, the Queen Agravain, will not let her son, Dauntless, marry any princess that shows up to marry the prince. Right. So she gives them ridiculous tests. A lot of them are like trivia. Like, what was it? It was like, oh, you have to name like the butcher's like half sister's daughter, middle name. Yeah.
So it's under the guise of screening.
Yeah.
But her
whole thing is just making unfair tests and then just saying, oh, she wasn't good enough for you. But in reality, he's a mama's boy. So she just doesn't want him to marry.
Correct.
The king is mute, and he was put under a spell, and the spell was that he couldn't speak again until the mouse devours the hawk, and you don't know what that means until the end of the story. So Lady Larkin and Sir Harry are in this kind of secret relationship because the marriage law of the land is that no one can marry until the prince marries. Mm-hmm. And since the queen is making that so difficult, a lot of people are in like secret relationships.
Correct.
Lady Larkin and Sir Harry are, so she's actually pregnant.
Yep.
And so she wants to hurry up the process of the prince getting married because otherwise everyone's going to know that she's pregnant out of wedlock.
Right.
Exactly. So Sir Harry sets out to find a princess because they've kind of exhausted all their resources.
The local princess.
Exactly. Yeah. So he travels like over far the hills into the swamp and he finds Princess Winifred, for Fred for short.
Mm-hmm.
And she comes, she swims across the moat. And so everyone's really like off put by that. She's not your conventional princess. So
we actually meet her before Harry comes back.
Because yes.
Because she beats him.
Yeah, by swimming the moat.
Yeah.
But she's very boisterous. And
unrefined.
Yes, and Dauntless actually takes a liking to her because she's so unlike any other woman that he's ever met.
Yeah.
And the queen is just very off put by her. So she gives her her hardest test yet, which is she, obviously, you know the story of the princess and the pea. They stack 20 mattresses and they slip a single pea under the mattress.
Well, first, she tries to tire her.
Yes, with the Spanish panic, which we'll talk about.
Yeah.
But her test ultimately ends up being
can she feel
a pea? Because according to the queen, a royalty is very sensitive. So if she was a real princess, she'd be able to feel any imperfection under any amount of mattresses.
Right. Yes.
And yeah, so at the end of the story, they had, you know, there was this whole thing of trying to get Sir Harry and the court jester and all these people to work together to help help them cheat the test.
Yeah.
So they end up stuffing the top mattress with armor.
Mm-hmm.
So Winifred can't sleep.
Yeah.
And she comes out in the morning after having stayed up all night. And she was like, I don't know what you stuff in your mattress, armor.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the queen is just really upset because that means she passed the test. Obviously, she didn't know about the armor. And then the prince kind of finally stands up to his mom and says, No, this is the person I'm going
to
marry.
She tries to like make an amendment. Let's think
about it. Yeah. And so it turns out that the mouse devouring the hawk was actually the prince finally standing up to his hovering mom.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden she goes mute and the king could speak.
Right.
And he kind of starts ordering her around and puts her in her place.
Yeah. He makes her like start hopping.
Yeah.
And
Fred and Dauntless live happily ever after, as do Lady Larkin and Sir Harry. And everyone's now allowed to marry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fun.
Okay.
Fun
very,
twist.
Very, very fun.
Yeah.
I liked the movie version better. But I missed. And that should, you know, I'm not trying to malign any productions, but like we had a hard time finding a good stage production to watch.
Yeah.
So the movie, it was just magical. The same thing that you claim about Disney Annie over my Annie is that just Disney's really good at putting sparkle on things. And they put some sparkle on this. It was really cute.
I'm sad we couldn't find a professional production, I have to say.
It was perfectly cast. I mean, Carol Burnett as the queen, rad. Right?
Yeah.
Zoe Deschanel, perfect. Mr. Schuster, great.
Yeah.
The prince, that was so funny to me.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's always done.
No, it
but
is.
That casting of like a dude in his mid-40s that's just like afraid to stand
no,
up
that,
to his
but
mom.
That's how it's supposed to be. I believe that is canon casting because you're supposed to be able to see just how long she's been doing what
right.
she's been doing.
Right.
If he
and
were
it plays.
18,
it's so funny.
Who cares?
Mm-hmm.
Winifred is, I believe, supposed to be a little bit older, too.
Yeah, well, I loved that about... Okay, so this musical, it does contain stereotypical archetypes that you would expect to see in a show that...
Was written in the 50s.
Well, also that you say, and it has a princess, it has a prince.
Yeah.
It has them, but they're not where they... should be.
At first you think Lady Larkin and Sir Harry are like the prince and the princess.
They are.
Yeah.
They're
the stereotypical delicate,
his
like
songs are
he's
better.
Really masculine.
His songs
and he
are
goes
just
out.
Like, look at me, I'm the prince. You know,
yeah.
I've got this glorious song. And
Dauntless is sheltered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so like Dauntless is timid. you know,
he's a mama's
Winifred
boy.
Is unrefined. Mm-hmm. So those archetypes, they're there, but they manifest in different ways.
Right.
Which I thought was adorable. You know what I mean? I think it's really cute to have like a different, you know, visual of the princess, a different visual of the prince.
Yeah.
I think it was really, really
And I like how many ways you can play Winifred too, because some people play it so comedic and some people just play it like really boisterous. And like,
I feel like that's, I mean, if you're playing a role that was played by Carol Burnett, are you going to, I mean, like you kind of have to
try to. Who did it in the revival? Sarah Jessica Parker did it in the revival. I listened to it. I didn't see it. There's like no surviving footage from that, but.
Well, we got into this a little bit, but okay, let's talk about characters. So we've got Prince Dauntless. Okay. Son of Queen Agravaine.
He's a mama's boy.
I already mentioned upon this. This is an opportunity for a hilarious casting choice.
Yes. I mean, the older, the better. If he was gray, it would be even better. We were talking about this. Like,
as long as it plays that he's younger than the queen.
If the mom is like a modern day kind of like Angela Lansbury kind of character, like just, she would be perfect, honestly. Like that would be crazy. Just like an old woman. That would be perfect. And then the son could be like even 60. And it would just be so funny.
So fun.
Yes.
Yeah. So Princess Winifred goes by her nickname of Fred.
She's Princess of the Swamp.
She's Princess from the Swamp. So again, I already said this. She defies the princess archetype. She's childlike and lacks refinement. She kind of gave me like a Shrek vibe.
Princess Fiona.
It was that same thing where it's like, this isn't the physical aesthetic of what I'm supposed to be seeing, but the character is so real and just like comfortable in their own skin that like we're kind of without a care.
You know what's funny about Princess Fiona, actually, in contrast to that, is that she has like that ogre alter ego that you're like, oh, this is a princess. Like, that's weird. But actual Princess Fiona looks like a princess, and then she just like burps and, you know, it kind of like...
No, I actually meant Shrek, male Shrek.
Yeah, I actually wouldn't be surprised if that was kind of like some inspiration for...
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me at all, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. So Queen Agravaine, the wife of King Sextimus, makes every princess have to take an extremely hard test that she creates in order to prove herself worthy to wed Prince Dauntless. She's smug and arrogant, typically played comedically, as we said, because it was... It was originated by Carol Burnett.
Yeah.
Anything to say about her?
I just said that she is very protective. She shelters her son, but she's also...
She had rat costumes.
She's... Oh, my gosh.
Just rat.
Okay, so I have to say, I'm not going to talk about, like, the high school productions that we saw as far as costuming because, like, it's not notable. But as far as the wonderful world of Disney costuming, Bob Mackie was the costumer, which if you know anything about vintage fashion, he was huge in the 50s and 60s.
Fashion.
Mark is a fashion scholar. So I won't speak too much on this.
But her costumes are just so
many crystals and like big headpieces. Mm-hmm. Just look up pictures, you guys.
Yeah, it's a really very, very fun character.
But she's a little bit tyrannical in the way that she runs the kingdom. A lot of it.
I mean, her husband can't speak. So, I mean, she's kind of got iron fist control. Yeah. Okay. King Sextimus. So the cursed silent husband of Queen Agravaine who wishes to make love with other women. That part was really weird.
Okay.
He communicates via hand gestures only until the end of the show.
Okay.
That part was very weird.
That was the difference, though, between the Disney one and the stage one. That
he's sex crazed.
We watch. Is that why he's called King Sextimus?
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously it's hilarious, but like he's chasing girls. From stage right to stage left.
You guys,
it's almost like the thing on Pirates of the Caribbean that they ruined and made backwards. But remember when it was when it was like guys chasing women?
Yeah.
Or actually, it was plenty also with the women chasing men with rolling pins.
That's what it is now.
Okay.
Which I kind of thought was a little bit funny.
Yeah.
But that's the one aspect of the musical where I was like, no, we probably could have left that one in the past.
Yeah. I feel like this is going to be a common thing when we watch an old show.
We're going to be like, yikes.
Don't get us started on The King and I. You know, like it's some things, if you do want to bring the show back, maybe we make some adjustments.
Because Disney did that. And honestly, I didn't blink an eye. Like, I wasn't like, this character's missing something.
Why isn't this guy chasing skirts?
Why isn't this guy trying to get the poo nanny?
Yeah.
I
yeah.
You know when people used to use that word?
Yeah.
Sorry, am I still in the time machine?
Yeah.
So. So that was weird. And you know what was even more bizarre about that was, so I've said a million times, we kind of melded together three high school performances because it's all that we had at our disposal besides the movie. Mm-hmm. So it honestly wasn't clear to me what he was doing chasing the girls because...
Because it was bad.
Because some acting was like, oh, nice.
Yeah.
Because some acting was just like, this is going to sound mean, but it was a little bit non-existent in some of the productions that we watched. So... It's just kind of a person chasing someone like emotionless.
Yes.
And so I remember looking at Mark halfway through and going, is he a perv?
Yeah, it didn't read.
And then King Sextimus, the name, I was like, this is gross.
Yeah.
It just made me a little uncomfy, but that's okay.
I wonder because, okay, so had they put it in the Disney one and you've got this great comedic physical actor, it probably plays. But it's just like the timing, you know, it's old and I don't feel like
don't feel like it needs it.
It doesn't need it.
Really doesn't need like, it. I just feel like if you're comedic, there's so many things the king does.
Without it, he's charming.
Yeah.
So you're giving him an element to dislike about him.
Without it, he's a medieval Charlie Chaplin. And you could play it like that.
Yeah. And he's got these like tender moments with his son.
Yeah.
So it's.
Which get gross you put it. Because then he does the whole pantomime thing. I know we're going to get into the song, but there's a whole song where they have a talk about the birds and the bees, but the dad can't talk. So he's like. And that's gross if the dad's a perv.
Yeah.
Like, stop it.
Yeah. So that was.
Like, this is how you do it. I try to do it with everyone in the kingdom.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. Bye. Leave.
Okay. So we've got the minstrel, which I love.
He's
okay.
The narrator.
The narrator of the musical. He helps the king and the jester, so he's friends with them.
Mm-hmm.
He's got just these gorgeously, gorgeously scripted songs. That first one, I mentioned there's another one that passes story. Like whenever he opens his mouth, it's just like really, really well-written stuff. That's the character I would probably want to play.
So the minstrel king and jester song is another good example of a time when the king could really play up the whole physical comedy because
100%.
The whole time you're supposed to almost be able to hear him singing along, even though he can't.
Well, yeah, we'll talk
every,
about
but as I said, we were watching a high school performance and I swear to God, one of the performances, the kid never changed his face. It's just like, and I don't want to rag on like 16-year-olds, guys. That's not my point. I'm just saying like, I didn't really know what it was supposed to be
It was hard to appreciate the scene.
Yeah, it was absolutely. And like, believe me, I was in high school 10 years ago. I remember the guys that were dragged into the theater program.
From the soccer field.
Exactly. Yeah. They're, hey, if you do this, you get credit. And they're like, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to put you in
the there's a bunch of girls in a room over there.
Do you want to be... Do you want to be a 50s guy in Bye Bye Birdie?
Okay. Yeah. the jester is a kind of an intricate character. He's meant to be funny, but he's kind of sad. Like, I don't know.
What?
He's friends with the king and the minstrel. And
he's also friends with Sir Harry.
Doesn't he also...
he helps cheat.
Translate for the king, right?
Yes. Yeah. And he also helps... he's the one that ultimately helps Sir Harry and all the group, like, cheat at the end. Because he ends up... translating what the king is saying about the challenge because he knows about the challenge.
Right.
I don't know. I don't remember how the king hid in the stage musical to hear about the challenge, but I do remember in the movie he hides in a suit of armor.
Yeah, that's like in a
it's
corridor.
So cute.
Yeah, it was very cute. I'm telling you, dude, the guy is just a genius of physical comedy. Okay, so Sir Harry, noble knight of the kingdom, in love with Lady Larkin. This fits the typical prince archetype, both physically and vocally, right? Like the way his songs are written are like, you know, what you'd come to expect of a prince's, like a, you know, a Disney version of a prince's song. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Lady Larkin, noble and refined lady of the castle. She's knocked up and wants to marry soon so that nobody finds out she's a pregnant bride. Typical,
relatable,
typical princess archetype, right? Like,
yeah,
very pretty, sings beautifully.
Yeah, and it's Zoe Deschanel,
perfectly played by Zoe.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And then
okay, we've got the wizard. That's a really weird character. It's
he's
kind of
like the
queen's
henchman.
It's the queen's jester, is what it is. It's the same thing. It's that relationship where she's got like a confidant, He does the test for her.
Yeah.
He administers the test for her.
But what's so bizarre is in the show, he's at like a cauldron and he's very wizardy. Yeah. And then in the-
But he does nothing wizardy.
Yeah.
He's dressed wizardy, but he does nothing.
It's so funny how like in the stage musical, he was straight up dressed like Gandalf.
Is that a word, wizardy?
No. It means someone that does things that are wizard-like.
Wizard-like. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know. It's weird that he was dressed like, you know, a Harry Potter character in one of the shows. And then in the Wonderful World of Disney one, he's just dressed like another jester. And he actually, there's no cauldron scene. There's no, and they had to take out the part where the minstrel like kind of, I don't know. In one of the plays, it was weird. This is what the tangent a little bit, but it was really weird how, so the jester in one of the musicals that we watched, like the staged ones, it was played by a girl. So they added this really like weird seductive,
That's the problem with and high so schools, I, dude. There are no dudes.
So yeah, like, but I'm wondering like what that scene is supposed to be.
Yeah.
Because I haven't seen it played by a boy. Yeah.
We were confused.
So that part was cut out. So really in the Wonderful World of Disney one, I don't even know if he's supposed to be a wizard. I think he's just supposed to be like the queen's henchman.
Yeah, I agree. I feel like it's the other side of the king having the jester. It's the
right, because the instead of, I will say in the show, she goes to like his...
he can't be bothered to do other stuff.
But she goes to his lair in the musical, like with all of his like potions and stuff around.
Okay.
And then in the movie, they're just in her chamber and she's like, what am I going to do?
Hmm.
Yeah. So I don't know. But okay.
So, and then lastly, is just the ensemble, men and women of the kingdom who wish to be married to each other throughout the play.
Yep.
I think the ensemble in this show is actually a good reason why there are a ton of high school productions of this.
Because
there's just, you know, it's just like, how can I get all these people onto a stage and give them something to do? And it's a good ensemble show.
All right,
show.
Guys. Look around and look surprised.
And you actually mentioned this, that like a lot of the people that sing, like a lot of the songs aren't exceptionally challenging.
I noticed that a lot of the students that sang in this, like they did a good job of casting the singers in the high school.
Yeah.
Because there's not a whole lot of those parts, and they stay in a very attainable range.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
So they give the one girl that can belt Winifred, and then they give the girl that just like uses the shit out of her head voice, Larkin.
The minstrel, the guy that's got a falsetto.
Exactly, and you can make those girls or boys that can like sing within like a 2-octave range.
Yeah.
And it works, and I understand that. But I feel like on a professional level, people think it's too simplistic.
It can it's be. Too- I mean, it definitely takes you there from the moment it starts. It takes you back. It takes you back. It feels like
a 1950s musical.
Musicals, and I like that. But it's looking at it. If I were like, would they revive this again? Probably not, or not for a long time. And I wonder if the revival had the Pervy King in 1996.
I don't know. There's nothing surviving, so I'll have to read about it.
Yeah,
but what I do appreciate about the show. Is the fact that you are not pigeonholed to a certain kind of character. It could be any race for all roles. So you could cast this any way you wanted. So it's a very inclusive show, and it's something that could easily be done by a lot of those theater companies. So sure. I understand that too.
Yeah.
It's not like Hairspray where you can't just whitewash the whole musical because then it makes no sense. This is like, who cares? Which I like.
Yeah, 100%. I agree with that. Yeah, I mentioned that it's good for high schools. We mentioned that. Movie didn't have the opening number, which explains the plot. Hit that. Soft Shoe. Let's just talk about songs. You wanna talk about songs?
Yes. I also do want to say though, when we're talking about like the production itself, it's a very easy set.
Super.
We were talking about that.
Super.
It's literally just a castle facade.
Yeah.
I mean, the Wonderful World of Disney one made it so like.
Well, they can.
Yeah, but
they
literally
had, like, interior shots.
Literally, guys, all you need for this is like you can put down the scrim if you want to, but
it's
a castle facade.
Yeah. Yes.
That's it.
Yeah. You can put down the scrim and make like bedrooms by putting in like a little vanity, right? Like,
yeah. You just pull in her bed with all the mattresses and you take it out.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's it, and then the rest is just the castle scrim.
Yeah.
But anyways, so what were you moving into?
Songs. It's two songs.
Yes. Let's break down the songs.
So, dude, I mean, just who does not love an overture.
I love it.
And this overture was, as I said, it was reminiscent of Rodgers and Hammerstein.
It was very long.
It was not very long.
It was very long.
It's overture length.
Look, it's got I appreciate all the themes. But we did fast forward a little bit.
No, you made me fast forward a little. I love an overture. We have Many Moons Ago by the Minstrel.
Yes.
Which is super adorable. He comes out with this little like lute, you know.
He talks about the princess and the pea. And
it gives
how
us the story
different.
Setting mm-hmm. immediately. Like immediately. So the Disney one, you know, it was several minutes in when I turned to you and was like, is this the princess and the pea? Which is on stage, you know, after the overture, like 60 seconds in, you're like, this is the story of the princess and the pea. And it's great. It gives you the setting, which is really cool. The song sounded like super, super Baroque-y to me in his...
Do you want me to play a little bit of it?
Accompaniment?
Do you want me to play a little bit of it? No?
Nah, we don't want it.
Many moons ago in a far-off place lived a handsome prince with a gloomy face, for he did not have a bride. Oh, he sighed, alas, and he pined, alas, but alas, the prince couldn't find a lass who would suit his mother's pride. For a princess is a delicate thing, delicate and dainty as a dragonfly's wing. You can recognize a lady by her elegant air, but a genuine princess is exceedingly rare.
It's super, it's just really, really cute. It's got really, really gorgeous high notes that he flutters in his falsetto. I like that song a lot. Okay. An opening for a princess. Do you remember this one? That's the ensemble one where they're all singing.
They're talking about what a princess is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. That archetype that we were talking about.
Right. Furthers the story of dire need for a princess because the entire town wants to get married.
And that's where you find out about the marriage law, because Lady Larkin has her point in that where she said, I can't believe none of us could get married until he does.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now we have just an adorable little duet in a little while.
My
Sir Harry and Lady Larkin.
Favorite song of the musical,
it's
probably.
It's just gorgeous. Yeah. It's just gorgeous. It is exactly what you'd expect a princess and a prince song to sound like. They're not the princess and the prince.
No.
But it sounds like what you'd want Dauntless to sound like. You know, it's very formulaic, and I say that in a good way. It goes exactly where you want it to go and where you expect it to go.
Can I say, I don't know if you had the same like notion when you started the musical. This is what I thought as it was opening up on the Wonderful World of Disney World. Mm-hmm. I thought that all of those women standing in the courtroom were all the prospective princesses.
Yes, I did as well.
I thought she was going to choose Zooey Deschanel, but Zooey Deschanel was sneaking around with the knight.
Oh.
I thought that was the plot because I went into Once Upon a Mattress not knowing anything about Once Upon a Mattress.
Neither did I.
And I was like, oh, this is a scandal.
Well, I definitely agree that I thought it was just a lineup. It was a cattle
call
of
princesses. And she was just going to like keep doing a test.
Go, yeah, yeah. I thought that. But I didn't
realize they were all of the ladies of the kingdom.
Yeah.
Which to me actually in my head doesn't make much sense.
Well, they're watching because they're concerned. They have a vested interest. They want to get married.
That's true.
So they're
were all the guys in there too?
There were dudes. I mean, it was like in a big castle. Like it was, I'm sure. The cluster was girls.
But that's what I thought. I thought she was sneaking out to be with the guy that she actually wanted to be with. And then it was going to be this whole thing. Like, it can't be me. It has to be someone else.
Okay. No.
Which also would have been a good plot. I should have been there.
Yeah, maybe.
Just kidding.
Okay. So we've got On a Stormy Night. That's the one I'm telling you about. It's a minstrel. It's a little snippet. The track on the revival is like 60 seconds, but he really only sings for like 15 of them, and he still manages to sound rhapsodic.
Is that the one where he's talking about Prince Harry going off and finding...
It just moves the plot forward. Yes, exactly. Okay. That's exactly what it is. Okay. It's just like, yeah, this is what's happening now. And it's a little snippet, and it's so, so, so pretty. Okay, so we've got Shy. Obviously, everybody knows this song.
Yeah, if you don't, that's when Princess Winifred... Fred. She comes back, she swims the moat, she gets out, and then everyone is like being shy around her. Mm-hmm. And she's
she says, who's the
the groom to be.
Yeah, she goes, who's the groom to be? Nobody wants to come forward. The prince is hiding. And she goes, I just want you guys all to know that I'm just as embarrassed as you are. And right. I'm actually really shy.
I confess it. I'm shy. Can't you guess that this confident air is a mask that I wear? Cause I'm shy.
Is this still an overdone audition song?
Was it?
Yeah, of course. Of course. This was the gimme gimme before it was gimme gimme. Like it was, yeah, this was an overdone audition song for sure.
It's so weird because I don't think that I would personally use it.
I mean, it depends on the character you're going for, but I would probably say still don't do it just because it's been overdone, you know, for years and years. But it is an adorable song.
It's I can't really see it being on my own, but maybe it is.
It's in a different vein than On My Own. On My Own's like, that's what I'm saying. Gimme, gimme. It's the belty. Like, listen to me scream. It's that one.
I just don't know in what, I guess if you were going for a really comedic character, it would make sense. But if you were going for a really comedic character, you probably wouldn't sing Gimme, Gimme.
I bet you it would kill in a cabaret, though. In a cabaret, it would kill.
Yeah. Well, it's good out of context.
Yeah.
We watched it when Dr. Bales put on the last show that we did for the fundraiser thing that he did every year.
Uh-huh.
Someone sang Shy.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. It was good. It's good out of context. Like yeah, those are good songs to
exactly.
do in a yeah.
Exactly. It's a good cabaret song. Okay, so we have The Minstrel, The Jester, and I.
Which is not in the Disney one.
Not in the Disney one. It is I is the king, but he doesn't sing. So they use like these clever orchestrations to kind of mimic the sound that you're not getting from him. It's really clever.
Which mixed with the acting is genius.
Yes.
Because then you can almost hear it.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. Next we have Sensitivity. This is sung by Queen Agravaine. This is an expository song. This is her telling everyone her evil scheme.
That's when she's like, if she was sensitive like royalty, she would be able to feel the
pain. But it's also like, let's come up with a plan that doesn't You're seem shady, such a but genius. It really is.
You came up with a P.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So it's we already know that she's sinister, but it's her telling us that she's sinister.
I believe it's the wizard character that mentions something and then she piggybacks off of it. So then she's like, you're so genius. I should put a P under the mattress.
At first he mentions table manners, which I thought would be very funny.
Yeah. Well, you said that actually before we, okay.
I think I did say
we
that.
Were sitting there.
But it's because I'm a she goes, snob I have of table
to come
manners.
Up. We have to come up with a test. And then he goes, what's it going to be like table manners? And then they did bring it up.
I'm legitimately a snob when it comes to table manners.
He's very he calls everyone that can't eat well, like Eliza Doolittle.
Yeah. Well, they're unrefined. But like, listen, like my godmother used to threaten to wrap me on the knuckles with the backside of a dinner knife if I didn't use my utensils properly. And by properly, I mean like literally like crossing hands.
So like, I do.
Like fork in left hand, cut it with your knife, put your knife down, switch your hand and eat with your fork in your right hand.
That's what I do because I can't cut with my left hand. Well, but I also can't. Yeah, I am cultured.
Right.
I've been to Europe one time.
Okay, so we've got The Swamps of Home.
That's where Fred is talking about where she came from. It's really cute.
She shows off her true colors. That's the one that really gave me the Shrek vibe. It's just, you know, you're being introduced to who we now know as a princess, and she does not come from a traditional fairy tale setting, right? Mm-hmm. It's a fun number. I thought it was cute.
Yeah, it's cute. I like it.
Normandy, this number was changed in the movie.
Okay, who sings Normandy? Tell me.
Okay, so Normandy is sung by the minstrel, the jester, Larkin, and King Sextimus. So everyone.
Okay, in the Disney one, it is sung by Sir Harry and Larkin.
It's a honeymoon, basically.
Yeah, which I thought was so cute. And then in the show, it's not that.
No.
It's, so we're going to get you out of here, Lady Larkin.
They're helping her get out. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's a getaway song in the musical. In Disney, it's, we're going to be on our honeymoon soon, darling.
Yeah.
In Normandy.
Right. And then we've got the Spanish Panic. So the Spanish Panic is the queen setting up the dance to purposely tire out Fred.
Yes.
And on stage, it's basically like, it starts like the time warp. Like, she's like, it's just a jump to the left, right? Like they're like learning how to time warp.
And I guess depending on the dance skill of your ensemble, I don't know how it's done professionally. This was a pretty simplistic one that we
Disney
saw.
The Disney one, it looked pretty, I mean, it looked cool.
It was a lot of like, it was a lot of tango inspired moves in the new one.
Yeah.
Which it was supposed to be like,
it was cool.
Yeah, it was cool. It was a very, very long number
it's
in
silly.
The movie because it's supposed to be like like a lot of exertion. So her whole point was to do the hardest dance possible to tire her out. So that way she would just knock out and wouldn't feel the pee.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And we close act one with the Song of Love, which is just your typical love song. He keeps singing like, I'm in love with a girl named Fred, which is hilarious. It gives me really Harold Hill vibes.
Yeah.
Some of the underscoring
this little
kind
pattery.
Of sounds marching bandy.
Yeah.
You know, and then like he just, it's very much like him selling us on this, you know, Tom Cruise jumping on the couch with Oprah. You know, it's like, I found a girlfriend finally, you know.
And yeah. it's a good parody too, because the whole time she's doing a lot of physical things that take her out of the archetype of that princess that we already know that she's not a typical princess. So she's like lifting weights and like jumping around the room they're all, it's funny. It's a funny
number.
Funny. Yeah.
Okay. So we have on track coming back in from act one. We've got Quiet. So this is Queen Agravaine. The ensemble also singing very loudly that the queen is demanding quiet. And we reveal the plot to secretly determine the nature of the queen's test.
Why don't I remember that song?
It's like when they're moving the mattresses.
Okay. In the Disney one, that's not in there.
It's probably, if it is in there, it's probably severely truncated.
If it was in there, I forgot. But
good night, sweet princess. This is in the revival only, but it was on the soundtrack that I listened to.
Okay.
It's Prince Dauntless singing like a lullaby type song.
I'm glad they gave him more songs.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Same. Happily Ever After, this Princess Winifred, she's reading all the princess stories that end with a Happily Ever After.
Oh, I liked
this
one.
And she's wondering when her time will come. And
that's
cute. Really
she sings
cute.
About Snow White,
she
Sleeping
Snow
Beauty.
White. She mentions Cinderella, I think.
Yeah, Sleeping Beauty.
Yeah.
It was cute. She said something about how like, oh, she has like seven dwarves that like are on her side and I've got like no one.
Yeah.
It was cute.
Yeah, totally. So this is the one that you were talking about.
That was actually what I was going to say. That's a very Fiona song. Because you know how the tower one?
Yeah.
I know it's today. And she's like talking about the waiting.
Yeah.
Yeah. She talks about like Snow White and she
skip ahead. Yeah, you're right.
It's so Fiona.
Yeah, it very much is.
Yeah.
Good point, man. So here's the weird one that you were talking about, Man to Man Talk. This is Prince Dauntless and King Sextimus. It's basically like the How Are Babies Made song, right?
It's just like, and the dad can't say anything. So the whole time is like, oh, I think I get it. Oh, it's the stork. Oh.
So I felt like this song is kind of
slow.
Inherently boring.
Yeah.
But I feel like, again, this is like an opportunity to let casting shine. So with someone,
listening to it is boring.
Yeah, it kind of is.
But if you have a good physical actor.
I mean, if you have someone like Tom Smothers.
Yeah.
And a good.
That was cute.
Dauntless,
I even think you could go more over the top than he did in the
you
movie.
You could. But it does open us up for an element of a charming moment between the king and the son and you know, he never speaks. So,
and I know he played it down because he was on film. I wonder how it was done on stage by a professional because when you're on stage, you have to do everything so exaggerated.
Yeah.
So that scene is probably a riot.
Yeah. Agreed. Very soft shoes. This was not in the movie.
The minstrel.
It's the jester.
Talking about his dad.
So yeah. The song is just kind of like, okay for me, but it did because we didn't see it in the movie. I would imagine that in a professional production,
it's a rad tap
they have
number.
A rad soft shoe number.
Yeah.
Like they must have just like this just insane dancer, you know, doing all like the really.
You
really
would have to.
You have to.
Because otherwise
you're just like,
it's
why is this
lame.
Here? Yeah, why is
like
this
we here? Saw again, we saw some of the high school choreography where you're working on kind of like a limited.
Well, I looked up some like I saw some really good, like I saw one guy that was regional and he was magnificent. Voice was okay, dance was stupid. And I was like, okay, I see the appeal of this song, but it really has to work. Like I said, if it's a professional production, obviously
The you're going to have a triple
super,
threat.
Super, super, super talented. And yeah. It's going to be, yeah, it's going to be a really cool song. Otherwise, it kind of just looks like an
I picture like a Gene Kelly doing that role. Right. Like, perfect. Yeah. Or like a Donald O'Connor. Just like, look.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Now we have yesterday.
For those people who are only listening, I pointed to the Singing in the Rain poster. I didn't just say, look, wow.
Yeah. We have Yesterday, I Loved You, Sir Harry and Lady Larkin. It's basically like the I Do Still Love You song.
We just had a fight. Sorry.
I will help you cheat
the
Queen's
They had
test.
A fight because she felt like he wasn't trying hard enough to marry her.
Correct.
He didn't want to cheat, so she was pissed.
Right. So now we will. Now this one is so weird. The Nightingale Lullaby, the song by the Nightingale of Samarkand.
Can I say my first
impression?
Tell me, please.
About this? Like, it just was so weird.
Okay, so
what are you talking
again,
about first?
We watched the Disney one first. It is the wizard in the loose wizard. It's the queen's jester.
It's the queen's lackey.
Yeah,
in a giant cage.
They dress him up like the bird. They wheel him in a big cage, and he essentially just like squawks.
It was very Iago, right?
But then he started to do kind of like a melodic like la la la.
So
la,
I didn't get the purpose. Was the purpose for him to stay in the room and spy on her, or was it really to lull her to sleep?
I think he was there to like supervise almost.
So spy on her.
Yeah. And then when
she can't sleep, she yells at him.
I think it was that he was supposed to stay there. And then when she fell asleep, he was supposed to go like tell the
queen.
Yeah. But it turned out that she kicked him out and then she just stayed up all night.
This scene's hilarious. This is when she can't fall asleep. So
she's moving around. She's thrashing.
The queen drugs her. Yeah. Right? She drugs her.
Opium
and warm milk. She has her smell some stuff. I don't know what those are. Something.
It's like, it was like an oil.
Right. She's basically.
It was rose and something. And then she hypnotizes her with a mirror.
She hypnotizes her. She puts her in bed. And then he starts singing. And she gets pissy pants and she kicks him out. But like the funny thing to me is the tossing and turning. It's ripe for a good comic actress.
And then she starts counting sheep.
She starts pounding on the mattress.
Yeah.
Like rolling over like a fucking little kid that's
having
a tantrum.
She rips it up and there's like feathers everywhere.
Like sleeping with her butt in the air, like in child's pose. Like it's very funny. For me,
all right, sheep, ready when you are.
And she starts counting sheep.
Yeah. Cute.
Right. And she never falls asleep. So we have the finale. She comes in, so she never falls asleep. She comes in and says, "What do you stuff your mattresses with? Jousting equipment." Very, very funny for me.
Like, yeah,
I audibly laughed for that.
I believe in the show it is jousting equipment. In the movie, it's armor. So she says, "What do you stuff your mattresses with? Armor?"
Something like that.
Yeah.
They open and they like
and
actually
they
physically pull.
Open up a flap. Did they ever do that in the musical in the stage one?
Yeah, of course.
They opened it up and showed jousting equipment.
I mean, it depends what you're watching, but yeah, obviously the bed is made with like a trap door to pull stuff out. Otherwise, in the
high school one we watched, I don't remember.
It was really awful. It was like a cornucopia and a pair of antlers. It was really. Maligning this poor freaking high school.
No, I'm not. I didn't remember.
Okay, so.
Wow, everyone's gonna hate me.
So.
Which one? There was four.
It is a very, very funny full ensemble closing number, right? It's adorable to end with the full ensemble. I love that. The final cadence is just so good for me. And I wrote down the lyric because it's so good. They sing, "For a princess is a delicate thing. Delicate and dainty as a dragonfly's wing. You can recognize a lady by her elegant air, but a genuine princess," and then you hear Winifred snoring, "is exceedingly rare."
Yes.
And it's sung in just glorious split harmony. It's really, really, really
It's cute. Really cute. And then in the world of Disney one, he just kind of like watches her go to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
It's cute.
Yeah.
I also, I didn't say this at the beginning, but just in case anybody's wondering, this takes place in medieval times.
It does. It does.
Which I can't narrow this down very much.
Not the restaurant in Buena Park.
This takes place at medieval times. They have a tournament. You can order some chicken while you watch it.
And if you get out early enough, you can go to Porto's and get a Cuban sandwich.
We could go to Knott's and ride Ghost Rider. So medieval times is classified between the 5th and the 15th century. So place it anywhere, guys. Yeah. I would say this is more like the 1400s, 13 or 1400s, like
Great.
Medieval Shakespearean
Good
times.
Good point. So that brings us to like how musicals age, you know what I mean? The fact that it's not taking place in present time when it was written, you know, you can kind of bring it back whenever, because it's just, it was never meant to be relevant to the moment, you know?
Right.
But that being said, we do find small little things that it could be amended.
I honestly, if I were to do this myself, I know that we talk about this a lot. Mm-hmm. One, I would make sure that the king's not a perv, because I don't think that you need it.
Yeah.
I mean, the bird is weird for me, but
it's weird
I would
for me.
Keep it in.
We just literally just talked about that. I just don't understand the purpose. Like, is it to narc? Is it to keep watch?
I would make that more clear.
Yeah.
I would add lines and be like, yeah, let me know when she's
right.
asleep or something.
Right.
Because otherwise it just looks like a creepy old man in a bird costume.
It's just a really
What is
weird.
Up with the creepy old men in this show? Yeah. I would just take all of them out. Also, I would make Normandy again a duet about the honeymoon, and then maybe you could do a reprieve, or maybe I would do Normandy as we're going to get you out of here, and then I would do Normandy as a reprise, like we're going on our honeymoon.
Oh, that's a cute idea. Yeah. That's a really cute idea.
Yeah.
I like that.
Because I like both. I like the purpose of both.
Yeah, you need it there for the purpose of like her wanting to run away.
And she hides. So she's not going to, you have to know why she's hiding.
Yeah.
Because she's about to show. So that's why she's doing that. Yeah. She's like, this is taking too long. I need to get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So awards and accolades.
Oh,
1960
tell me.
Tony Award nominations. Best musical nomination, and it did not win.
What won that year?
It lost.
What years?
Oh, dude. Daddy coming down with the fury.
What is
she it? She lost to her father. Well, it was actually a tie. But it was a tie between The Sound of Music and Fiorello. So
wait, so who was in
but
who was Maria?
Papa Rogers, dude.
No,
smacking down.
He was not Maria.
Not stepping aside.
He's not Maria.
No, I'm saying Papa Rogers didn't step aside to let his little girl.
I know. It's
let
so
his
funny.
Progeny get a little limelight.
Progeny.
Dang.
It was a 1996 Sound of Music
1960,
revival?
1960, woman.
Oh, just kidding.
What's wrong with you?
Got it.
Second nomination was Best Performance by a Leading Actress to Carol Burnett. Also did not win. She lost to Mary Martin.
In The Sound of Music.
The Sound of Music. So sad.
Yeah.
1997 Tony Award nomination for Best Revival of a Musical.
Did not win.
Did not win.
What won?
Chicago. Yeah, that kind of makes me sad.
So Chicago was a... When was Chicago?
I'd like to think that... This is 1987, girl.
No, I know, but you said Best Revival, so when was Chicago Revive from? Do you remember?
Oh, no.
You don't remember when that was a musical from?
No, but I saw that production, not anywhere near 1997. I probably saw it more like in, Jesus Christ, it's around for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I didn't really care for it, honestly. I mean, it was okay.
I've never seen Chicago, so I guess we'll have to watch that.
I think I saw 4 or 5 shows that trip, and it was definitely like my least favorite.
I know the songs from Chicago.
Yeah.
I've never seen the...
No, I'm not. I mean, yeah. Songs are great.
I've never seen Chicago.
I don't even know. I don't...
I've seen Chicago.
Yeah, well...
It's not bad. It's a good show.
Yeah.
I just didn't care for that.
What do you think? What do you think? Do you like the movie better?
I like the movie. The movie's okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's okay. We'll get there. We'll get to that.
All right.
That's it, man. So, thoughts on this show? How many thumbs? Is it?
How many
do
thumbs?
Do we do 4 thumbs or 2?
All 10 of my
stars?
Fingers.
How many? How do we do this? I like this show. I think it's charming. I think it feels like the shows of yesteryear, which I love.
Let's give it.
I love that.
How many playbills are we giving it out of 5? That's what we'll do.
We knew nothing about this show, right?
Uh-huh.
So we kind of came in with 0 expectation.
I think
I like it a lot.
Given a if I saw it in a professional respect, I will factor in how I felt about the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I would give it like a 3 3/4 or 4 out of 5.
Okay,
4 is probably a little high. I would give it a 3.5 out of 5.
Okay. I'm okay with that. Yeah, I'd lean it. Between.
Should we do out of 10 so you could put it on a regular grading scale?
You know,
I'd give it a solid B.
Okay. So it would pass. It would advance to the next grade.
It would pass. I'd get B minus or B.
Hey, man.
Yeah.
C's get degrees.
That's
B's
all we
B's
could,
just
that's
for
all
showing
we could
off.
Ask for.
Okay. I like that. Who would you want to play in this?
If I were redoing it?
Like today, someone's casting it today. Full open call. They say, "I want you." Who do you want to be?
Okay. So, I think for this is hard. For Lady Larkin, I would want like Laura Osnes.
Okay.
I think she's the perfect like princess.
I'm not asking you to cast the show. I'm saying you in the show.
Oh, me in the show?
Yeah.
This isn't like if I had
Laura Osnes in anything that I was casting.
But this isn't like I have unlimited funds. This is like I'm putting it on regionally.
No, you're acting in this show.
Oh, who would I want? Winifred probably.
Okay.
I think
I see you as Larkin.
I knew you'd say that.
I'd cast you as Larkin.
Yeah, I know you would. Yeah. But I feel like I could do Winifred. I think it'd be a fun challenge.
Okay. I'm okay with that.
Not even so much like challenge. I just think it would be something different that I'd have fun with.
Yeah. I'd want the minstrel all day long.
I think
the minstrel's super fun.
I think that the way I'd want this casted, though, I think I'm too young to be Winifred.
I'm not asking you to cast the entire show.
Girls. No, I know, but I'm just saying I would want Winifred.
Dream world here where you just
get that I could be any age.
Make believe we're, yeah. Have you
And then
the
I'd want Winifred.
And, okay.
I wouldn't want the queen.
Mm-hmm.
Would I get to put on my villain accent?
I don't know. You do you. That's
my cartoon villain
accent. Those are character choices.
What would you, if you were the queen, would you put on a cartoon villain accent?
No.
No.
No, no. Stop making fun of high schoolers. It's not nice.
I'm not.
It's not nice.
I'm not. It was a funny choice though, the whole time, because no one else did that.
You know, there's like this whole thing where you're not supposed to bully people. It's like this, it's like this whole thing that like, you know, the youth are like obsessed with. Just like. Anyway, so all right, well, I liked it. I'd give it a passing grade as well. I'd give it a B+ if I was, you know, second grade.
I think
teacher.
I'd like to see it done professionally, and then
I would love to see this done professionally. Like I do think it would be rad to see it come back with a couple little tweaks. I'm not talking anything major, but yeah, a couple little tweaks. It would be really cool to see it on a Broadway stage. I like it a lot. All right, man. That's it. Anything you want to add?
No.
Thank you, Ted.
Thank you,
well,
Ted.
I mean, honestly, that's kind of all we have for the show. But let's find out what we're talking about next week. Yeah.
All right, y'alls. So here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna
So tell me first the 14 titles that made the cut. Well, not made the cut, but made the list.
So
the list is growing too.
I think we're over. Sorry, I need to get this. Where's my wheel? Okay. So this is what I have. We have falsettos.
Word.
Daddy Long Legs.
Interesting. That's
Fred Astaire.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And I think it's also on Broadway HD, the musical. So
yes.
That's we would watch both.
Chicago.
Oh, snap!
West Side Story.
Word.
Fame.
Oh.
Gross.
We won't. We can't get into that yet. We can't get into that.
We're going to save it,
stand by on that one, people.
My heart sank.
Stop. Stop talking shit. Why are you talking shit today?
The high school one I was just
next
being funny.
Next one!
Follies.
Okay.
Legally Blonde.
Sondheim. Oh, word!
Mm-hmm. Love Legally Blonde.
Samesies.
Bring It On.
Okay.
Ragtime.
Word.
In the Heights.
Oh.
Yeah. Mark's fave. Man of La Mancha.
Okay.
The Student Prince.
Okay. So we just mentioned Mario Lanza.
Yeah,
twice,
it's Mario Lanza.
We just mentioned Mario Lanza twice in one episode, and it's not even about him. I hope it's the Student Prince.
You're in Town.
Okay.
And Once on This Island.
Oh, word.
Which I've never seen, but I've heard great things about.
I saw the revival, like, what, 2-3 years ago?
Did you love it?
It's a cool show, man. It is a really
Aren't
cool
you, like,
show,
surrounding man. Them?
No, yeah, yeah. But it's also, like, it's really, it's just, like, it was, like, sand on the stage and, like,
oh,
running
cool.
water. There was, like, livestock. There was a goat, chickens. It really is submersive, dude. Like, it was a cool show. It was a very, very cool show.
So let's spin it. Let's see.
That was it? That was 14?
Yeah, that was 14. Let's see what's going on.
Student prince. Fame, student prince. Fame, student prince. Fame, student prince. Fame.
West Side Story.
What? That's too major to do.
Yeah.
Oh my God, we're getting some big ones already.
I know. I'm excited about this.
West Side. Can we do?
Spielberg is about to make a new one.
I don't think I could do it, but I'm going to try. Yeah.
That's how I wish everybody walked down the street,
Same-sies.
By the way.
Yeah. With the like, dun, dun, dun.
I love the, we're in a gang.
I know you don't watch Scrubs, but Scrubs season one tackled West Side Story. It was really, really rad because his best friend is a surgical student and he's a medical student. And so they're like rival gangs and it's really bitching. It's a good one. Watch Scrubs, everybody. It's on the Hulu.
So, all right. And also shout out to Lucid Dream Studios for making this podcast possible. Thank you so much.
So that's a wrap on Once Upon a Mattress, guys. Thank you for listening.
And stay tuned for next week when we tackle West Side Story.
How do these people find us?
Oh, follow us on our socials, everyone. Well, one social as of now.
Okay, what is
Maybe
it?
By the time this is on, I'll be sure to make something happen. But it's Not Another Musical, at Not Another Musical on Instagram.
Word.
And then you'll be able to find us on YouTube, Not Another Musical channel. And then I'm also making a TikTok with small little pieces of our show on it.
And you're probably already listening to this, but it is on the Spotify and on
Apple Podcasts. Mm-hmm. You can find us on both places. And then, yeah, just be sure to follow our socials to stay updated. We'll be, asking you what you think of the musical that we're tackling. And there's just going to be all kinds of fun content on there. And then you can find West Side Story. I believe it's on Netflix.
I mean, it should be in your DVD cabinet. Yeah. And if it's not,
but it's on Netflix.
But it's probably also on the Netflix.
It's on Netflix for sure. And then we're going to be finding some production to watch.
First of all, we're distraught that we didn't get to go see it this season because I heard nothing. I don't even want to say I heard nothing but good things. I heard nothing but exquisite things.
Yeah.
Like, the people that saw it could not stop raving about it.
I've always wanted to see it live.
We are very, very hopeful that when the apocalypse is over, that West Side Story survives and comes back because we will be there.
Perfect. All right, guys.
That's it, guys.
Well, that's a wrap. Thanks so much.
We'll see you all next week.
All right, you guys. Bye.
Take care.
I'm sorry, but the stuff about the high school is cracking
you
me up.
You needed to stop saying.